A recent discovery in neuroscience is a network of interconnected nuclei that are responsible for the sense of self, self-image, self-awareness, and self-consciousness. It is called the default network because it is activated when we go into our own heads, by default, shutting out the external world to focus on our own private thoughts. When researchers ask participants, "Are you thinking about something other than what you're doing right now?" 30 to 50% of the time, people say yes. Going into our own heads, so to speak, is natural for a brain, so it does it a lot. Let's look at a descriptive table from Kalina, Christoph, and colleagues that describes thinking habits. The x-axis in this table is deliberate constraints, referring to how much control we voluntarily apply to our thoughts. It ranges from weak to strong. The y-axis is for automatic constraints, the thoughts that we can't control, ranges from weak at the bottom to strong at the top. So when we can't control our thoughts, that's called rumination or obsessive thinking, depicted at the top of the table. The rest shows normal spontaneous thinking. On the left is dreaming, which is a spontaneous thought that we have little to no control over. When we're awake and mind-wandering, that's when we let our mind off its leash to run free into its imagination. This is healthy and valuable because it can show us what we want and on some level show us who we are. As we daydream and mind wander, that's when we can solve problems free from some of the psychological restrictions that we tend to place on our more deliberate thoughts. And that's when creative, original thinking can appear. If we come up with an idea for a new song, a new tool, or the answer to a personal problem, that's when we constrain our thinking and get to work. We have moved into goal-directed thought. As you see, mind wandering is the birthplace of creativity. Robin Wilkins and Donald Hodges are researchers at Wake Forest University who are interested in music cognition. So they brought participants into the lab to scan their brains as they listened to three categories of music: liked, disliked, and their favorite kind. The researchers discovered a remarkable thing. When people listened to their favorite songs and other music that they liked, their default network became active. The blue arrows point to the frontal lobe region, where some of this network resides. Now, a nucleus called the precuneus is nestled deep in the back of the brain. It belongs to the default network and is important for creativity. During this listening study, the precuneus acted a bit like a bouncer at a nightclub. When listening to liked and favorite music, the precuneus permitted strong connectivity with the rest of the default network. When listening to disliked music, the precuneus cut itself off from the network and, in the words of these researchers, became connected only to itself. We see this in the disliked condition. The frontal lobe gets deactivated while the precuneus strongly attempts to prevent disliked music from getting integrated into a sense of self. Studies like these provide physical evidence for what we feel when we listen to the music we love or cannot stand. Our favorite music activates the default network and accompanies us into a private journey to our own psyche, letting us daydream and go where our minds enjoy going. This is why everyone's music-listening brain is so unique. It was shaped by all of the pleasantly rewarding music-listening experiences of our past. And it represents a part of you that no one will ever really know, your private sense of self. In this way, our musical loves can feel like friends. In the next video, we will look at the listener profile, and I will give you a tool for understanding why you love the music that speaks to you the strongest.